lovelies, it's Purrmage, back with more shenanigans. I still sound like crap, and I'm sorry. Let's get past it. So today, I wanted to do a little process video with you. Those of you who follow me on other social media have seen me making these drawings in my sketchbook, like these. These were the first two. You guys love them. I love them. I'm super proud of them. And they seem to be going over super well. Everybody's, you know, giving me a lot of positive feedback about them. And I'm really excited about that because obviously this is my art and people like it and that's super cool for me. But I've had a lot of people talking about how, you know, I've got like smooth gradients and they love how the color is kind of blended together. And, you know, I just wanted to do a little process video of how I achieved that. So I have a new line drawing. This is the third one. For those of you who didn't see it on other social media. So I have a new line drawing. I didn't color it yet, but I'm going to now. So I just wanted to kind of show you that like I'm not using these crazy supplies or anything like that. I'm literally using this miscellaneous bag of pens. And in here is literally like, I'm not using pencil for these, by the way. I'm super proud of myself. I'm doing all of the underdrawing in ballpoint pen. So this is just a Bic, like I probably paid like $5 for a bag of like 50 of them. Like this is a really cheap pen, but it's working out really well. I mean, I really like how the lines work out with this pen. And then, you know, the stuff that I'm putting on top of it blends over it really well, which is nice. But so there's no pencil on these drawings at all. So I'm just using a regular ballpoint pen. A couple of other products that I'm using are the Pilot V5 Precision. I have the colored ones and a black one. And then my favorite, my secret weapon, which I actually just bought a new pack, so I'll show you the new pack. So it's Staedtler Tri-Plus Fineliners. They have the super cool case, which I should have kept of my old pack, but you literally, like, you open it, and then you snap the top of it to itself, and then you've got, like, this cute little easel case. It's so nice. So I've had my first set since college, so probably my second year of college. So that's about 6 years that I've had them, and they're starting to die, finally. So I had to suck it up and buy another pack. This pack at Michael's was $32. I know that Target carries them. I don't know if they carry the big pack or only the little pack. I don't know if they carry the big pack or just this pack, which does the same thing, by the way. It's still like a nice little easel case. It's just smaller. But Target might be cheaper. I'm not sure. I had a 40% off coupon, which is the only reason I splurged and spent the money on myself. So I spent like $20. So like $1 a pen. They're well worth it. I promise. And after you watch this video, I doubt you're going to disagree. So I have the ballpoint pen, I have those guys, I have the Pilots, and then my other secret weapon is the whole fill it with water, use it anywhere paintbrush. These are like $7 a pop, so I want to say that there's like a 3-pack for like $9. Get the 3-pack, don't be an idiot like me. I wasn't sure if I was going to like them, so I paid $7 for one when I could have paid $10 for three and had three different tips, which is what I should have done. I'm mad at myself about it, too late now. But these, again, are well worth it. You can mix paint or ink with the water, too, and it works really well like that. Or I just like to use water. I use this with my watercolors and with my Tri-Plus fineliners. Now, the big deal with these guys is that these are porous pens with water-based ink. So because they're water-based, they will blend and smear when you add water to them. Which is my secret weapon. They say a magician never reveals his tricks, his secrets, and stuff. Artists like to share, or at least this one does. So that's my secret, so you'll see that. And then I also just use, you know, a couple of various different paintbrushes and acrylic paint. I personally prefer Golden. Golden is a company based in upstate New York. I actually got to tour their factory warehouse, I don't know what they specifically call it, while I was in college, which was super cool. But the quality of these paints is ridiculously good. Basically, I'm just gonna color for you guys today and just kind of, I'll talk through a little bit. Obviously my throat is dead, so I might not be super talkative, But hopefully this time I'll remember to plug music in too, so that you guys aren't just watching in silence, because, you know, that's what I did with my Bujo setup, and then I was like, oh, oops, newbie mistake, it happens. I have to just kind of forget that and move on and not make that mistake again. So, without further ado, let's color this drawing, and hopefully we don't mess it up. So the first thing I want you guys to know about these is I do not plan the color palette beforehand. I know that a lot of artists will do that. I don't. So once the color is down, if I made a mistake, that kind of just is what it is. And so let's hope that that doesn't happen and call it a day. So I have been consistently doing metallic tints. You can probably see that on this guy, on the cheeks and the chains and the jewelry. So I already know that I'm going to be doing the like metal parts and the chains and most of the jewelry that way. So that I usually leave till last because that's acrylic paint. I'm using either iridescent pearl fine, which is a golden color, or I'm out of my gold golden. So that's funny. But so I have Liquitex acrylic, which is gold. So I've been using these two, and then if I want to add color, sometimes I'll mix in like a color with the metallic paint. And it gets like an interesting effect. It doesn't always work the way that I kind of intend for it to, but it does look kind of nice. So I do that sometimes. But so since these are acrylic, and they're going to be a heavier paint and they're going to kind of sit on the surface of the paper a little bit more, I always do these last. The first thing I like to do is the skin. And on this one, I've kind of given myself a little bit of breathability because most of the other ones have a lot more skin than this one does. This one literally is just like the face, the neck, and the ears. I didn't show any of her chest. Although I guess to be fair, I didn't do that on a lot of them. But I also drew this one smaller. I actually was going to abandon this drawing because I didn't like the size. I had drawn just the head shape of it with no details. And then someone that I am mutually following on both Twitter and Instagram, Persephone Rise, I will link her social, basically kind of convinced me, gave me the motivation, you could say, that, you know, even mistakes are worthwhile. So I decided to revisit it and finish it. And I'm really glad that I did because I actually really like this drawing. So generally when I'm doing skin, I like to pick kind of like a middle tone, what I want the highlight to look like, which has been yellow pretty consistently, just because it's a nice, you know, it's not white, but it gives me a nice base. And then also I try and think about complementary colors. So if I'm going to be using like shadow, I'm going to want like a blue if I'm doing like a yellow and orange type of skin tone, because that's going to feel more natural and kind of how it's supposed to be. So I think for her, because she's a little older, I'll still go with the yellow base. I want her to look a little sickly, so I'm going to do a light gray as kind of the tone that goes over that. And then because I'm doing yellow, it would be purple for the shading. And then just to give her a little bit of color, but not too much, I'll go with kind of this purplish pink. So that'll be for the darker areas as well, but it won't be just a straight shadow. And basically what I'm doing is I'm just trying to use the older pens first so that, you know, they'll die and then I can throw them out and then I'll know that the ones that I have are good. So something I learned at art school is that if you're going to be using pens and doing lines like I do, you want to follow the shape of the body. So, you know, I'm drawing on a flat piece of paper, but if this were a 3D object, i.e. a person, she would not be flat. So I kind of curve my lines a bit, so as if it's going around the neck. And that gives it depth and dimension, especially when I start blending the colors out. It'll look a lot more realistic if the lines aren't just straight across or straight up and down. I always do the neck first just to make sure it's gonna look the way that I want it to look, because that way, you know, the neck is always gonna be in shadow. So if it's not working out quite the way that I envisioned, I have time to then make adjustments before I do it on the face. And you may have noticed I'm leaving a lot more space between the gray lines than I did between the yellow lines, and that's because I don't want her to become super gray washed. I just want her to have kind of like a sickly pallor to her skin. And if I did it too close, it would get really dark and it would basically look like I was doing a black and white drawing instead of a full color drawing. And the same idea with the purple, because this is the shadow, I don't want it to take up too much of her skin because I don't want it to look like her skin is purple. So it's a good thing that this pen is actually dying because it gives it a little bit more of a sketchy line, and that'll be much more easy to smooth out and blend with the water. And then just to give her a little color, we'll add the pink just on the edges and just right under her chin down the middle. And hopefully this will be a relatively light skin tone that's a little bit grayish. So then I'm just gonna take this guy and I'm gonna blend it all out. So the pink obviously took a lot better than I was kind of anticipating that it would. So on the face, I'll probably go a little bit lighter on the pink and a little bit harder on the other colors, just to kind of get that look that I'm going for. But I'm not really mad about this, so I'm not gonna go over it again and try and like fix it after the fact. That's kind of been what I've been doing with these, is if something doesn't quite work the way that I thought it was going to, I just keep working with it because I'd rather kind of see where it goes rather than just scrapping it or trying to change it and making it worse. And because I've given her wrinkles, I've given myself kind of sections of the face that I can do, which makes it a little bit easier than trying to draw a line that curves over all of the curves of the face, which is what I've had to do with the others. So I'm pretty excited about this. I don't normally draw older characters, and I was really excited to kind of try drawing some wrinkles. If anybody has tips on drawing elderly people, other than the obvious one, which would be to draw from life more, which I could definitely stand to do. But if anybody has any tips besides that one, because I know that one, I would really appreciate it because I usually draw a lot of really young, pretty women, and I kind of want to expand my skill set a little bit. So it'd be cool if anybody had tips for me. So again, I'm going to go a little bit darker with the gray this time because I didn't feel like it showed up very well on her neck, but I'm still going to give myself some room other than where I really want it to be darker. And a good rule for cross-hatching, if you want to make a space darker than the rest, is to go the opposite direction. So I'm literally crossing across the lines I already drew, just in a different direction, and that'll kind of layer the color in a way that'll make it a little bit darker. So I just kind of followed the creases where the wrinkles were that I drew. And then again, I'm gonna go really easy on the purple and the pink this time. So I'm just gonna do it where like I really think the shadow would be. And then I'm just gonna kind of give her a little red on her chin. And keep in mind, I am working a little bit wet on wet, so that will kind of affect this line of her chin and her neck. I may have to redefine that a little bit better later because I've kind of smeared it by working next to the wet section. And this I probably will revisit with more color because that's very yellow and that's really not what I wanted. So I'll probably go back in after this is dry and add a little bit more color and then smear that out again. This is what I got, and I'm not actually all that mad about it, so I guess we're gonna keep going with this kind of an idea, and I'm gonna do the ears and see how that turns out. So that's the skin. And as you can see, I've got the gradient from dark, where her hair is kind of casting a shadow on her forehead, down to the light, where the light's hitting her cheeks, and then the shadow under her chin. I actually don't know that I'm going to re-hit this. I was thinking about hitting this again to get a little bit more brightness in there, but I think it's okay. It feels a little concave from what it would actually be, but I'm not actually that mad about it. So I think I'm going to leave it and just kind of move on. So that was all the first day that I worked on it. That was actually a few days ago. So sometimes I do these in one sitting. A lot of times though, especially because of the amount of detail that I put into my drawings, they do take longer than one setting. But I'm back. I'm gonna tackle some more. I redyed my hair. And now I'm gonna try and finish this in tonight, and then we'll be all set. So my thought with the roses is to make it kind of look like it's stitched or embroidered onto her sweater. So that's why I'm doing kind of these little tick marks. And then just like with everything else, I'll hit it with some water when they're done. And hopefully the pen mark will stay well enough and you'll be able to see it, that it'll have that stitched feel. But if not, I can always go back in on top of it and add that in. So that's kind of the plus side to this, is like I get to experiment, but nothing is really, if I make a mistake, everything can kind of be revisited and adjusted and fixed if it needs to be. And that's one of the things that I like about working this way, is that because I add the liquid, and then once it dries, you can always add more material on top of it. And that's why I like working with thinner materials too. I like working with acrylic paint, but a lot of times with acrylic paint, if you make a mistake and then kind of try and paint over it to fix it, you end up with kind of a mess because it gets kind of goopy because it's so thick. Whereas working with water kind of thins everything out, and that way you can add more and more material on top, and as long as your paper holds up, you're not going to run into that issue of it getting cakey or weird. Watercolor kit that I made. It's literally like a pill divider, and then I took little pieces of plastic and cut them to the size that I needed to split up my colors. Obviously you can see I mix colors, like this is yellow but there's green mixed in, and I can take this with me anywhere. It fits right in my backpack, and I really love it, so I'm pretty proud of myself for this. So for all of the other ones, the background square, I've mixed a color, but for this one, I really, really like this color. It's called Smalt Hue, which is a type of blue. This is Golden Artist Colors, which is one of my favorite brands of acrylic. I'll be using this number 10 round Princeton Art Brush & Co. paintbrush for the bigger swatches, and then my favorite right now company is this Royal and Langnickel Zen, and this is a liner, so it's like a super super thin paintbrush, and I'll be using that to get in these like little detailed areas, and that's what I'll be doing. So I know I was shooting on time lapse and you guys couldn't really tell, but my hands were shaking pretty good. So you can see I've got kind of a wiggly line here, got a little bit of a mess here. And the rest of what I have to do for this is all really precise. I'm going to be doing, just like I did with the flowers, I'm going to be doing stitching in the cardigan and then watering it. And then after that, it's just the jewelry, which is all really precise metallic paint. So unfortunately it looks like this is going to be a 3-day piece. I'm going to have to come back to this another day. They're not just shaking in general, but when I'm trying to do my detail work, they're shaking pretty bad. Sometimes that just happens, for me. So,
all right guys, it's time for day 3. I got my new glasses, so I'm pretty excited about that. I have hair sticking out. Oh well. So I'm excited because today we're going to be doing all of the detail stuff, all the metallic paint on the jewelry, and finishing up that cardigan that was giving me some trouble last night. I'm super stoked. So, day three. So the first thing I'm going to do is the cardigan. All that's left is jewelry. Alright guys, so that's it. It's done. So it did take me 3 settings. Settings, whatever. But she's all done. She joins her friends. So I've done 4 of these now. Got these 2. And then these 2. And yeah, so it took me 3 different settings. I just basically, I sketch it out and then I color it. So thank you so much as always for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed this draw with me. I can speak. It's been a long day and I'm ready for bed. But if you would like to see more art, or if you would like to see still images of this piece, you can check me out on all social media at Purrmage. I will link all of my supplies down below in case you are interested in purchasing any of them.
And yeah, thanks guys. If you're in the US, have a happy 4th of July, since that is when I am going to be posting this, is on Independence Day.
And if you are elsewhere, just have an awesome day, because every day is a good day for a good day. And that's all I have to say. Don't forget to subscribe if you're new here and ring the bell so you always get notified when I post new content. Love you guys. Bye.